is going on here?
Dean Longfellow, meet your ghost problem.
Mitchell from the gas station?
That's right. They said I wasn't good enough to go here. I wasn't Kingston material. If I'm not, then no one is.
Mitchell used the ghost to scare away all the incoming students. That way, you'd be forced to go further down on the admissions list until his name came up.
Great work, kids. Okay, you. Come with me.
Hold on. Just a second there, Joe.
Mitchell couldn't have done this alone.
He needed an inside man. The head of security.
Yes, I recognize him now. That's Joe's son.
Right. After 15 years of protecting the school, Joe was angry when his son was rejected. So, they swore revenge. Joe signaled Mitchell with a holographic ghost illusion in the tower, which they sealed up so no one would find him. Mitchell would come over in the ghost disguise and scare everyone away.
But when you still wouldn't lower the university's admission standards, they had to get rid of you too, by framing you for fraud.
Handwritten lists slanted to the left, which means it was written by a lefty, but you're right-handed. Only Joe had complete access to the campus to plant fake evidence, and he's also left-handed.
And we would have gotten away with it too if it wasn't for... Run!
Good work, kids. Honestly, I have no idea what's going on here.
Allow me to clear it up for you. Our hunt for Chuck wasn't a complete bust, because the Sitari warrior is...
Chuck Mangum!
Chuck Mangum!
I missed the clues at first, but they were all there. The warrior was reckless and he displayed the same athleticism as Chuck. And the glow sticks Chuck was using to light the caves are what gave the warrior its supernatural gleam.
Rick told us that the Sitari warrior of legend only attacked those who were after the treasure. But we weren't trying to find the treasure, we were trying to find Chuck. Which left the question, why was he attacking us?
The answer? Chuck was herding us through the caves, keeping us on the path to where he knew the treasure was, but couldn't gain access to it himself.
Because, unlike a Sitari warrior, Chuck didn't know where all the traps were.
So, like, how did the warrior attack Chuck in the video, then?
We fell for the oldest trick in the book. In the video, we never actually see Chuck and the warrior at the same time. He either gave us subtle glimpses of the warrior using lights and recorded sounds, or it was just him wearing the mask himself.
Chuck, I just... Why?
You think I like being the dumb one? That last gate stumped me. I knew you'd be able to figure it out, because you figure everything out. But I didn't want to ask for your help, so I tried to trick you into helping.
By asking for his help?
What part of dumb one didn't you get? Anyway, I would have gotten away with it if I was smarter and planned it better.
Good work! I'm already feeling like a great burden has been lifted off my shoulders.
I'm glad, Cousin Scott. Now let's see who our sea creatures really are.
Aye, Dive Master Thorn and Dahlia.
Of course! Only the SSKC is allowed in Bribery Bay, so Thorn and Dahlia could illegally scavenge the sunken ships for treasure, and dressing as sea monsters from Legend was the perfect cover. It kept people out of water so no one would discover what they were up to.
To stall for time while they collected and hid the treasure, the bolts from the ship's engine were removed. Then, they faked their own abduction. Unfortunately for them, they dropped the wrench they used to sabotage the ship.
The gold doubloons we found were dropped by Thorn and Dahlia as they snuck the pirate treasure up to the SSKC.
And the huge air tank was reserved for the fake monsters to refill their tanks, so they could stay underwater longer.
And we wouldn't have gotten away with selling the doubloons and making millions if it weren't for you meddling kids!
Take these guys away.
Ladies and gentlemen, meet your gargoyle.
Carly, the assistant director?
That's right. We didn't see it at first, but all the clues pointed in one direction. We knew it couldn't be a real gargoyle because the dust from the monster was plaster, not granite like the statues around the balcony. Plus, in the legends, a real gargoyle was supposed to protect its building, not destroy it like this one was doing. The strange slime we found on the lobby statues was grease that Carly used when she made molds of the gargoyles for her costume.
But why'd you do it? Whatever your name is?
That's why. Because I'm invisible, even though I do everything around here. I should be the director, not that insipid little ferret. I figured that if I got him fired, I'd finally get a chance in the director's chair. And I would have gotten away with it, too, if... Well, no, actually, I can't back that up. The odds were pretty much against me in hindsight.
Yeah.
Good job, kids.
Just in time, too.
Who's our culprit? The pinch hitter for the legendary Chip Braverton is none other than...
Dustin Walsreath!
But why? He was a lousy player, but I gave him a good job. Revenge! Dustin never forgave you for cutting him from the team. And a gypsy moth doesn't go down without a fight. He tried to scare away all the fans so the franchise would tank, and Jack would have to sell off the team.
The first clue is Chip's batting stance. The real Chip batted right-handed. Dustin here batted left-handed. But the real clue was statistics. Chip's batting average was 394. When Dustin tried to fend off the pitching machine, he only connected with 4 out of the 26 balls. The exact batting average Dustin had with the Mutts, 154.
And Chip looked pale as a ghost because he covered himself in calcium carbonate, the white powder they use to line the baseball field. And that's what those tiny white dots were in the tunnel. Dustin got the powder on his cleats, which slowly came off as he made his way onto the field.
And my plan would have been a home run, too, if it wasn't for that meddling super fan.
I can't... Great work, everyone!
Yeah, now let's see who's really under this mask.
Professor Salazar!
It all makes perfect sense.
It certainly does.
Yep, and Jeff, you led this case, so you should have the honor of telling everyone how we figured it out.
Thanks, Fred. We knew that Sobek was scaring people away from the Egyptian exhibit, but why? Well, the first clue was the second statue we found on the scene.
Exactly.
That could only mean one thing.
Yep, and that is...
Sobek was kidnapping barbers and transforming them into statues to appease the angry corn people of Kathmandu.
Whoa, wait, corn people, what?
It all came together when the Falcon found the mouse in the storeroom. This revealed that Sobek was clearly trying to stop the wind. All wind. Forever!
Whoa. Maybe I should take over here.
But of course, the real puppet masters were the red leprechauns that haunt my every waking moment.
Okay, that definitely didn't happen.
And so clearly, as anyone can see, Professor Salazar is really Mr. Peterson, my third grade teacher who said that I'd never climb Mount Everest's invisible twin, Mount Flappy McFlunkin. Why won't this Professor Salazar mask come off? Reveal yourself, Mr. Peterson!
Well, I thought we were reading the same things into those clues, but no, you are really bad at this. Obviously, Salazar knew there was a gold statue in the sarcophagus. She wanted to steal it and finally escape the brutal world of Egyptology, so she used the legend of Sobek to shut down the exhibit.
Wrong!
She used parts from an alligator display to make her costume. The deity Sobek had a crocodile head instead of an alligator, a detail most people wouldn't notice. She removed the gold statue from the tomb and hid it in the Egyptian exhibit. She was going to sneak it out of the museum.
And I would have gotten away with it too if it wasn't for you meddling. And in your case, crazy and misguided kids! My plan was perfect. Sobek is even the patron god of robbers!
Ha! Your scholarly research is as shoddy as your attempts at crime. Sobek was a guardian deity.
I don't have to listen to your poorly sourced nonsense. Take me away!
Oh, no, you don't. Take me away, too. I'm going downtown with you to keep explaining how wrong you are in jail.